Welcome to week three of Business Law, and this week we're going to look at chapter four of the textbook, which is entitled Business and the Constitution. You may wonder what the Constitution has to do with business, and you may be surprised to learn that there are several different aspects of constitutional law that do in fact impact business. And so we're going to take a moment to step back and look at the Constitution, how we got it, and some of the different parts of it that may actually be relevant to the rest of our studies and also to your career as you engage upon a career in the world of business. Well, the Constitution is important for a couple of reasons. Some provisions of it actually may be directly relevant to things that we do in the world of business. But more than that, it's also the foundation of our entire legal system. And I think it's important that we understand how that system is built to understand the various parts of it we'll be studying. And we can't really understand the legal environment of business without understanding what that environment is built upon. The Constitution is the basic law of the United States of America. It sets up everything else that happens in a legal sense within the borders of the U.S. And so we're going to take a moment to kind of go back, look at how the Constitution came to be, some basic aspects of how it's set up, and then look at for some particular provisions that may have relevance to us as we go about our careers in the world of business. Okay, bear with me, I'm a history major. I think this stuff is important, and I think you'll maybe agree with me that it is helpful in understanding how we ended up with what we have. Let's go back to the beginning of our country and kind of look at what was going on there. I think if we understand the motivations of the people who actually wrote the Constitution, that'll help us understand why we ended up with what we have, and help us remember what we have, which is helpful for tests, if nothing else. And we'll kind of understand why it was written the way that it was. Well, reaching back into your mind, back to a U.S. history class, either in high school or college, or maybe an American government class, you'll remember that we had 13 colonies, which started out in what is the United States today, founded by Great Britain, and they started in several different ways. We had the Pilgrims going to Massachusetts, and we had other people trying to make a buck going to Virginia, and Catholics went to Maryland, and all these kinds of things. Basically, we had different groups of people who, for whatever reason, thought they could find fame or fortune in the New World, or were trying to get away from something in the Old, be it religious persecution or whatever. So we had some religious minorities, such as the Pilgrims and the Catholics and other groups that came over to start a new life here. And some people that, you know, they weren't making any more land in Europe, and so they wanted to come over here and get cheap land and farm and make a living and a life for their families. So we had people with different motivations coming over. And when they got here, they tended to take care of their own business, really. They were still subjects of the king in London. But really, the British government didn't take a whole lot of interest in running the day-to-day lives of the colonists for a long time. And so that allowed the colonies to kind of develop their own homegrown government. Every colony had a royal governor who was the representative of the king that would kind of tell people what to do. But there were also elected assemblies, which ended up becoming state legislatures later. And the colonies pretty much took care of their own affairs. And the governors liked to do things with the consent of the assembly, because if everyone had bought in and everyone agreed, then everyone was easier to get along with. And so pretty much the colonies got used to taking care of their own stuff without a lot of interference from across the pond. Well, that started to change in the 1750s and the 60s especially. We had the French and Indian War, which, if you remember that from way back in history or maybe a government class, the French had colonies in the New World as well, and the French and the British historically hated each other's guts, and so they started fighting in Europe, and then that spread around to other parts of the world, including North America, and the British and the French armies started fighting each other, and their colonists started fighting each other, and their Indian allies started fighting each other, and we had a thing called the French and Indian War, where the British and the French got to fighting each other, and a lot of the American colonists got involved in that as well, including George Washington and some other folks that we would recognize their names. And this war dragged on for a while, and to make a long story short, the French got beaten and kicked out of North America. We still have their legacy today in Quebec, which speaks French, But for the most part, you know, the French were gone and we were victorious and wasn't that great, except that the British government decided that the American colonies needed to help pay for their defense during the French and Indian War. And they'd been pretty much left alone, but suddenly the British showed up and started imposing taxes on people in the New World, trying to get money to pay for the substantial cost of the French and Indian War. And so they started taking a more intense interest in the affairs of the American colonies. And that was kind of a jolt after so many decades of minding their own business, not being bothered from London. Suddenly the people from London show up and start pushing people around and start collecting taxes and that sort of thing. And that really led to a bad place. And you may have heard or have been left with the impression that the American Revolution started because of taxation. We remember the stories of the Boston Tea Party and stuff like that. Certainly taxes played a role, but that was kind of the catalyst. It really wasn't the cause. The cause was the American colonists felt like they were second-class citizens. They really felt like, you know, we're British too, but here you're coming over and treating us like we have no rights. And anyone in England would have had a representative in Parliament who would have been voting on whether a tax was a good idea or not. But no one in America had any representatives in Parliament. And so the old saying, taxation without representation. And so it was, you know, the taxes kind of were the, I guess, the cause, sort of, but not the root cause. The root cause was the American colonists felt like they were not being respected. They were felt like they were second-class citizens in their own country. And they felt like they'd been controlling their own affairs just fine. Thank you very much. And why are these British people showing up trying to tell us what to do? And they really felt like their rights were being infringed and their honor was being besmirched and all of those kinds of things. So the taxes, like I said, were kind of the catalyst, but it was a lot deeper than that. A whole lot more was going on. They really felt like they were second-class citizens in their own country. The king didn't respect them like he did his other subjects. And so, you know, by George, if he's going to act that way, we don't really need him. And so the stirrings of revolution started to happen. So, as the relations continued to deteriorate with Great Britain, the colonists was for the first time really started getting together and conferring with each other. And this is hard for us to kind of understand in our modern world. You know, we can drive from one U.S. state to another and really not, if we don't see the sign, we don't even know we've gone from one state to another. But the different colonies were really different, very different places back in those days. A completely different feel, different population, different, you know, cultural norms and all kinds of stuff. They were really like 13 little independent countries in a lot of ways. And so them acting together was kind of an unusual thing, but they all recognized that they had a common problem in their relationship with the British government. And so they started trying to meet together, try to figure out some way to solve their relationship crisis. And that was what led to the First and Second Continental Congresses, where all the different colonies sent representatives to meet together and try to figure out some way to get better relations with the king and his government in London. And so they tried to meet together, tried to work out some kind of compromise or something, and the British, for whatever reason, were kind of in a snippy mood and just really weren't having any of it. They were kind of like, you know, we'll show you, you need to listen to us, and this is what we say, and this is what you need to do. And so both sides couldn't really come to any kind of a mutually agreeable arrangement. And so things kept deteriorating, and I won't bore you with all the details. I think I have more in my written lecture notes. But things started to spiral out of control to the point that shots were fired. The revolution, the American Revolution, got started. You know, the Declaration of Independence was sent, which had all kinds of wonderful ideas you would learn about in an American government class involving the rights of man and where they come from, the social contract and all that kind of stuff you may vaguely remember. Anyway, they basically said, thank you very much, King. We really don't need you anymore. We'll take care of this ourselves. We're now an independent country and you should get out. And of course, the British didn't like that. And everyone started shooting at each other. And we had the American Revolution. And so now you had 13 little independent colonies that really hadn't worked together before, suddenly facing the greatest empire on the face of the earth in battle, and that was a problem. And so they needed to organize themselves together some way that they could kind of work in concert together. And so we had the first American government created with the Articles of Confederation. And Keep in mind that the different colonies were not used to being one country or one colony. They were 13 little independent states. And so for them to come together at all was kind of a stretch for them. And so the Articles of Confederation look very different from what we have today. And we'll look at that more carefully in just a second. But anyway, so we had that happen. Eventually, to make a very long story, very, very short, the Americans won, thanks in part to the French, and we have independence. And so the United States of America is actually a recognized country and continues on its merry way and making its way in the world. Well, we're still stuck with the Articles of Confederation, and frankly, they stunk. They didn't work very well at all, and we'll look at why again in just a second. But basically, they didn't. The root problem was they didn't create a very strong central government at all. The little colonies, which were now states, still wanted to be basically independent entities. They kind of distrusted each other in some respects. They didn't want to create some strong central government that would take away their own power. They didn't want to give up that power to some, you know, grand central government. So the national government under the Articles was very weak and had very little power. And as it turned out, that was problematic. We had all kinds of things that were kind of going wrong. But it came to a head when we had something called Shays' Rebellion, which happened in Massachusetts. And basically what happened there, we had Revolutionary War veterans who were wanting a pension paid to them, and they were upset and all this kind of stuff. Anyway, they all showed up at the State House to protest and carry their pitchforks and their moonshine and whatever, and their muskets probably, and all that started causing a big fuss. And the governor of Massachusetts got really scared and asked the national government for help. But the national government was so weak and ineffective that they really couldn't help. And so that scared the you-know-what out of people, because they said, okay, you know, if the national government is not capable of putting down a rebellion by a few drunken farmers, you know, what are we going to do if the British come back? And so they started to realize that, you know, we like being little independent states, but you know what? You know, we really need some kind of strong national government, or we're going to be up a creek if some kind of crisis happens again. Because, you know, they lived every day with the possibility that the British might come back. And in fact, they did in the War of 1812. That was against the British, too, which happened not too long in the distant future. So there was a real fear that, you know, there was some kind of outside threat might show up and the national government would not be up to the task. And so that made everyone realize that there was really some kind of problem that needed to be fixed. And so we got a convention together to fix the Articles. And that was its stated purpose anyway. The different colonies sent representatives to meet together and talk about what our national government ought to be like. And the idea was to fix the Articles. However, the representatives got there, they shut themselves behind closed doors, and they said, look, guys, we all know that the Articles stink and they aren't fixable. We need to start over from scratch. And so this convention became known as the Constitutional Convention because it ended up writing the Constitution. And so they basically started with a clean slate and said, okay, let's start over and let's create a national governmental system that will be strong enough to protect us from external threats and all these other problems that might arise, but also give enough power to the different states. And so they ended up coming up with the Constitution. And the Constitution ended up with several different features. One is it had three branches of government, and that was something that was important to the colonists, was not to, or now Americans, was not to have power concentrated too much in any one spot. That was something they had seen was wrong with the king and his government, was that there was too much power at the top. And that kind of power can lead to corruption, it can lead to tyranny. And so they wanted to separate the powers, and so they ended up creating the judicial, executive, and legislative branches and separating the power so that no one person would have too much, or no one branch would have too much. And so that was to prevent kind of a repeat of their recent history, which was having a government that was overbearing and tyrannical. We also have a system where each branch depended on all the others. So no one branch could do everything itself. Each one needed the others to cooperate in order to get anything done. And so again, that was separating that power out so not too much got concentrated in the hands of any one person or group to prevent the same kind of situation from happening again, where you have a central government that's despotic and is trying to run people's lives for them. We also have checks and balances built into the system. Again, you may remember this from civics, but every branch, you know, has ways of keeping an eye on the other branches. And for instance, you know, the president can order people around, but only Congress can write the checks. And so that kind of has a check on the president's power, and so on and so forth. The president can appoint people into different federal offices, but you know, sometimes the Senate has to agree to that. And so we have different ways for the different branches to kind of check up on each other. And so, again, that keeps any one branch from turning into another King George. We have the principle of representative republicanism built into the system, which basically means that the people have a voice in the government, but not too much of one. There was really a fear in that time, and it was a very different time, that people, as a general rule, weren't all that educated, and that's true. They weren't. A lot of, probably the vast majority of people couldn't read. And if they couldn't read in those days, they couldn't get the news, because it was either word of mouth or reading the newspaper was all that you could do. You couldn't watch TV and find out what was going on in the world. And so there was a real fear that, you know, the great, you know, unwashed masses of people would have too much power. And so what they decided was, okay, we'll let the people participate in a democratic way, but we'll let them elect people to represent them. And so that was built into the system as well. Also, we end up with a federal system, and we'll look a little bit more in a slide or two at how that differed from what they'd been doing previously. A federal system means a stronger central government, but it shares power with its constituent governments, in this case, the states. And so we have kind of a parallel system of governments, with the states having some power and the national government in Washington. Well, I guess then it was New York, but never mind. Anyway, the national government had a good deal of power, but not all the power. Some of the power was left with the states. And so they shared the responsibility of governing the country. And we'll look more at how that kind of takes place in a little bit. We also had the principle of reciprocity, which is that states had to respect each other's laws and each other's citizens. Basically, the idea was to keep the 13 states, from acting like 13 little independent countries. You know, we didn't want people to have a passport to go between Virginia and Maryland. That would be silly. We didn't want, you know, the government of Virginia to pass a law that said, you know, if you're a resident of Maryland, you have to pay some extra tax or something. You know, we wanted the people of the United States to be citizens of one country, you know, not citizens just of their state. And that was really kind of a mental breakthrough in a way, because again, you know, it's hard for us to understand, but these different states really felt like very different places. If you went from one to the other, you would notice. Because it was a different environment, and we wanted them to not just be looking out for their own citizens, but to be thinking themselves as part of something bigger, part of the United States of America. We wanted the states to really be united and treat each other's citizens fairly, the same way, and that kind of thing. So we have those mechanisms of reciprocity. We also have a system with the Constitution that is created a very stable system of government. But it was open to change. And part of the problem with the Articles of Confederation was there was really no good way to change it. Everybody had to agree. And trying to get everybody to agree on anything was not an easy matter. So the Constitution built in a way to amend it. You know, it's not easy to do. It's quite a chore, but it can be done. And it's been done 27 times. So it is possible to fix the Constitution if it turns out something is wrong with it. In reality, over, you know, the 200 and however many odd years we've had, you know, it's held up really well. But anyway, we can change it if we run into problems, so we don't end up with another article situation with some kind of crisis that we can't really fix very easily. I think it's worth noting here that the Constitution was ingenious. It was way ahead of its time. We kind of take it for granted, I think, but it was, no one had really ever tried this before. Here was a situation where you had no king. you know, in the past, the philosophy was God gave power to the king, and the king ruled the people. Here, it was a completely different political philosophy where they thought, you know, God gives the power and the rights to the people, and the people can choose their own government. And that was something revolutionary. It had never been done before to have this kind of, you know, democracy hadn't been seen since ancient Greece. You know, it was really something remarkable, not to have any kind of king or anything, and just have, you know, people voting, choosing their leadership, and going off in the world. And the system that the Constitution set up with the different branches of government That was completely new. There were just so many things about the Constitution that was just so remarkable. It was really, you know, centuries ahead of its time. And so let's not forget that. You know, we can be proud of that. You know, we live in a country that was so innovative, and now the, you know, the ideals in the Constitution have spread their way around the world to where democracy is more common than not. And so, you know, it really was a groundbreaking thing. But at the time, not everyone was that impressed with the Constitution. Ratification wasn't certain. And in order to come into effect, it had to be agreed to by the various different states. And people didn't really understand what was going on in the Constitutional Convention, who weren't a part of it, because they really met behind closed doors. They didn't tell everyone what they were working on. And so, you know, they'd met to try to come up with a fix to the articles. And then after, you know, months and months of meeting there, they come out and say, "Hey guys, we decided to ditch the articles and come up with this new constitution thing. We think you'll love it." And the people were not all that sold on that. They're like, "What are you doing? You know, we didn't tell you to do that. And what is this thing? And what's it going to do? And this is a strong national government you've created, and we're not sure that we like that." And so it was really an iffy proposition on whether the constitution was going to be ratified by enough states to take effect. And so there was a healthy debate about that, and there were debates that took place in the press. The Federalist Papers, which you may have heard of, were written by folks who were at the Constitutional Convention who were trying to convince people that it was a good idea, and they were trying to explain to people why they did what they did. And so those have been very helpful in trying to understand what they intended the Constitution to be and how they intended it to work over time. But anyway, there was a healthy debate. A lot of people had a hang-up with the idea that there wasn't any kind of list of rights of people that the government was sworn to protect. And that was a real big problem for a lot of people, because the British had trampled over everybody's rights when they were fighting the Revolutionary War and before. But they would do all kinds of things. They would censor the press. They would put, you know, there was no free speech. They would do all kinds of nasty, dirty things that people were really fed up with. And so they wanted to make sure that if they were going to create this strong national government, that it wouldn't do all the nasty things the British had done. And so they wanted some kind of list of rights. And the people who had written the Constitution said, "We don't really need that. We have just given this national government the powers that we've given it, and it can't do anything we didn't say that it could do." And so there's really no need to say the things it can't do, because it can only do the things we said it can do. But a lot of people weren't convinced, and so what we ended up having happen was a compromise to where they agreed that we would amend it as we adopted it. And so the first 10 amendments of the Constitution, which we now know as the Bill of Rights, were drafted, which protect our rights from government interference. They thought those were God-given rights. You know, the government doesn't give you rights. God does. We just want to make sure the government doesn't interfere with those. And so they wanted those listed. And so the Bill of Rights were added to the Constitution. That won over most of the doubters, and so the Constitution ended up being ratified, and we have what we have today. One thing that the Founding Fathers had to decide when they were writing the Constitution was just how exactly would we have the relationship between the states and the national government. And that was a key issue, because the states really, again, felt like that they were independent little countries almost. They had an independent existence. They didn't have that much in common one with another. You know, the people in Georgia and the people in Massachusetts really didn't feel like they had that much in common. And so being one country was a new thing, and the states really didn't want to give up that much of their power. And so there was a real question, you know, at the start of our country, you know, how that relationship between the states and the national government would work. And there are really three different possibilities when you look at forms of government, what you can have in terms of how the national government works with its constituent parts. The easiest model to understand is a unitary government, and that is usually smaller countries use this model. And a good example is France, where there are little provinces in France, but they owe their complete existence to the national government in Paris. And basically they only have the powers that the government in Paris decides to loan out to them. And it can take those away at any moment. They have no independent existence of their own. And so really everything is run by the central national government. Everything from things like national defense and foreign policy to deciding what textbooks go in your kids' elementary school, you know, down the street. Everything is controlled centrally. And so that's a very easy model to understand. It has some ups and downs, but if you take my American government class, I'll cover in more detail. But anyway, that's the simplest form of government to deal with. We also have a possibility of confederation. And in a confederation, it works a lot like the modern-day European Union looks. If you know anything about that, we have different national governments in Europe, countries like France, Spain, Italy, Great Britain, Germany, who have come together and decided we want to have some kind of centralized bureaucracy, and we want to cooperate on a number of issues, but we still want to be independent countries. And so those countries have gone together and done that. They have a common agriculture policy. They have a common immigration policy. They've done a lot of other things together, but they each have their own army. They each have their own government. They each have their own foreign policy. And so they do a lot of things separately, and the bulk of the power is held by the constituent parts. And so in the European Union, the individual countries hold most of the cards, but they've loaned a few powers to that central government in Brussels to do certain different things. But that's a lot like what we had before the Constitution, actually. So that's one possibility as a confederation. Then we have a federation, and that's really what we have today, where we have the different parts of the constituent parts, the states. They have sovereignty, and so does the national government. They share that. And so in our current system today, the state of Missouri, for example, has certain powers that the federal government in Washington cannot take away. The federal government's gotten better and better about bossing states around in recent years, but there are certain things that the state of Missouri reigns supreme within its borders, and the federal government can't tell it what to do. And so we have that, but we also have a very strong central government that handles a lot of different things. And so we have basically two parallel systems of government, the federal government in Washington and the state governments in the different state capitals, and they work together and they share power, and that's what a federation looks like. The Articles government, as I alluded to, really was a confederation. The different states loaned their power to a central government, but they didn't loan very much, and there were lots of things that the national government under the Articles could not do. It could not levy taxes, for example, which is a real problem, because if you can't raise money and you have to depend on handouts from the states, that really cuts down on your effectiveness. So it really just didn't have a lot of power. And so the Articles government was a confederation. It was a loose grouping, basically, of these different independent little states that decided, okay, we really ought to have some kind of coordinating body, in a national government, but we don't want to give up very much power. And the Constitution really changed that. It created a federal system to where the national government really has teeth. It really does have power. It can boss the states around on certain things. We give it certain powers to do certain things. The states, though, retain a lot of power. And so that's what we see in our system today. Well, let's look a little about how federalism actually operates in a nuts and bolts kind of way under the Constitution. One thing we have is the full faith and credit clause, and that's to make sure that the different states respect the laws of other states. It would make no sense if we're living in one country that we could enter into a contract in Missouri and then end up in a lawsuit in Kansas about that contract, and Kansas says, we don't care about Missouri contract law, peh, and just ignore it and say, you never had a contract, we don't care, that's a Missouri contract and we don't recognize Missouri contract. Well, that would completely shut down interstate commerce. That's a bad idea. We really want the different states to treat each other with respect and treat each other's laws with respect, because then we feel like we're living in one country and not, 50 different little countries. And so the Constitution forces states to give each other's laws respect through the full faith and credit clause. So if you end up in a lawsuit and you get a judgment against a defendant in Arkansas, and that defendant is found in Missouri and has a nice bass boat that you want to levy on, to satisfy the judgment, you can come to Missouri, take that judgment to a Missouri court and say, see, I have an Arkansas judgment, I want this guy's bass boat, and the Missouri court has to respect that. So that's what the full faith and credit clause does, is make sure the different states operate like they are basically in one country. We also have something called the Privileges and Immunities Clause, and that makes sure that different citizens are treated the same as they travel from one state to another. Just to use a silly example, it would be wrong and unfair if we had a different speed limit on our highways. Missouri residents can go 70 miles an hour, but everyone else has to go 55. That wouldn't make any sense. And that's, like I said, a silly example, but we want the laws of a state to apply equally well to its citizens and citizens of other states. We don't want to discriminate against citizens of other states. To us, you know, in our modern world, we'd be like, well, why would you want to do that? But in those days, it really made a lot more sense because, again, you know, the Yankees up north and the people living in Dixie didn't see eye to eye on a lot of stuff. And, you know, there was some real state pride and, you know, the idea that they might discriminate against each other's citizens. So we don't want to do that. We also have provisions for extradition. So if someone's running, you know, from, you know, a criminal warrant in one state, ends up in another state, and that state catches him, they have to send him back. So that makes sure that states respect each other's criminal laws and work together rather than independently and that kind of thing. Finally, the Supremacy Clause is really important. And that makes sure that the states have to respect the federal law. So if the state of Missouri has a law, you know, that says one thing, and then the federal government passes a law that says something else and contradicts that Missouri law, as long as the federal government has the power to do that, then Missouri has to obey the federal law. So if the Congress and the president, you know, passes and signs respectively a law that says something and the state doesn't like it, that's too bad. The state has to obey it. Unless it's unconstitutional, then they can fight it in the courts. But, you know, states can't just willy-nilly ignore laws they don't like coming out of Washington. And so that makes sure that in the areas where it has power, that the federal government reigns supreme. And that was really important. And it was different from the Articles era, where states could kind of thumb their nose at the national government if they didn't like it. So we didn't want that to happen anymore. And so the Supremacy Clause was put in there. I think I said finally, but I didn't mean it. One more thing, preemption happens where, let's say that the state of Missouri passes a bunch of laws on a particular subject, and then later on the federal government decides to regulate that area, those state laws have to give way to the federal laws. We'll have particular areas where the federal government has pretty much exclusive power to regulate something. For instance, let's just take the example of radio. Radio stations, you know, you have to get a license, you have to go to the FCC in Washington. Let's say, you know, early on, like the 1920s, when radio was just getting started, you know, let's say that, you know, Missouri decided to pass a bunch of laws regulating radio. Well, you know, that wouldn't work to regulate on the state level very well, because, you know, if Missouri, you know, licensed radio stations and they were on the same frequency as stations across the border in Kansas, and then there was interference and it wasn't working real well, you know, that would have been a bad situation. And so if the federal government comes along and says, look, everyone, we're going to take care of this, and the states have to butt out, that's preemption. You know, basically the federal government has total power within a particular subject matter area to make the law. And so we'll see that crop up from time to time in different areas. And states have to give respect to the federal government to be able to do that. And so that's the concept of preemption, to make sure the states don't butt in where they don't belong and get in the federal government's business. And so we have all these different provisions kind of making sure that our federal system operates like it's supposed to. Let's look now at specific powers within the federal system. And we can classify different powers the government has in different ways. One thing is an expressed power, and that is where the Constitution itself specifically says in black and white words explicitly that the federal government has the power to do something. For instance, regulating interstate commerce, that is commerce between states, that is given to Congress explicitly by the Constitution, and there is no question about it. It is right there in black and white. Congress can regulate interstate commerce. And so that's an expressed power. And that's pretty much the easiest to understand. And so if the Constitution says you can do it, you can do it. And that's an expressed power. We also have reserved powers. And reserved powers are not given to the federal government. They are reserved or kept by the states. And kind of the default situation was the states got to do everything. And the Constitution took some of those powers away and gave them to the federal government. And so we can look at it that, you know, the powers that aren't mentioned specifically in the Constitution, those were reserved or kept by the states. An example of that is police powers. And police powers are just general law and order type stuff. You know, police and fire protection, the day-to-day business of keeping law and order. Most of that stuff is kept by the states. And especially originally, nowadays, you know, we have, you know, the FBI and the ATF and the Justice Department and, you know, federal marshals running around and trying to, you know, do law enforcement stuff. In the earliest part of the country's history, you know, almost all of that was kept by the states, and most of it still is. I mean, if you call 911, you're not going to get the federal government showing up on your doorstep. It's going to be, you know, your local government, which is part of the state government. So that's an example of reserve powers. We have some powers that are denied powers, which means nobody gets to do them. And an example of that is an ex post facto law. An ex post facto law is something that European governments had done, which is patently unfair, which is to make something illegal after it had happened and then throw someone in jail for doing it when it wasn't illegal. So, for example, you know, we could make spitting your gum on the sidewalk illegal on Thursday, and then go and arrest Bob for spitting his gum out on the sidewalk back on 2 days earlier on Tuesday and throw him in jail. And you can see that's completely unfair. And so the Constitution goes out of its way to say you can't do that. And so that's a denied power. The states don't get to do it. The federal government doesn't get to do it either. And so some things are denied completely. We also have concurrent powers. That happens when the states and the federal government both get to do something. And an example of that, unfortunately, is taxation. The federal government can tax you, and so can the state government. They both get to do that. And so a lot of things are shared by the states and the federal government. And we also have implied powers, and this is gets into a little bit of a gray area. It's things that aren't mentioned explicitly in the Constitution, but we kind of understand that the federal government gets to do them because it has to. It's implied by other powers that it's given. An example I've put here is creating the Air Force. And if you look in the Constitution, Congress explicitly gets the power to create an army and a navy. Well, this was written in 1789. No one had even thought of an airplane yet. And so, you know, would it be okay while, you know, Hitler is invading Europe to say, oh, I'm really sorry, the Constitution doesn't say you can build airplanes to go bomb Hitler? Well, no. We recognize that, you know, that has the army and navy stuff has to do with national defense. And if we need, you know, these newfangled airplanes to defend our country, and then we have an implied power that Congress gets to build an air force. Another less obvious example is creating a national bank, which was a contentious issue early in the country's history. But Congress had the power to create the money supply. Well, if you're going to be printing all this money, what are you going to do with it? You know, and so creating a national bank was seen as an implied power to help regulate that money supply. So there are different powers that Congress has which aren't explicitly, or the federal government, and not just Congress, may have but aren't explicitly spelled out word for word in the Constitution. And so sometimes that becomes a gray area. And states are not big fans of implied powers because they want to have as much power as they can for themselves, and they're liable to argue that something is a reserve power if it's not mentioned rather than an implied power. But anyway, the federal government's desire for power is something that has evolved over time and grown and grown, and we have a lot of things that are seen as implied powers today. Speaking of federal power, let's look at the Commerce Clause. And the Commerce Clause is what gives the Congress, and by extension the federal government, the power to regulate commerce between the states and with foreign countries. And in the beginning, that was a fairly pedestrian clause that didn't have all that much teeth to it. And in those days, most commerce happened within a state. You know, most people never left their home state. But there was, you know, some commerce happening, you know, that, you know, cotton from South Carolina would be shipped to New Jersey to be turned into sweaters or something. And, you know, that was taking place. And so it was obviously something that the federal government, the national government, needed to be in control of because it involved more than one state. And we didn't want different states, you know, charging tariffs or something on stuff coming from other states. That would be silly because we're all part of the same country here. So that was given to the federal government, and it didn't really do a lot with it, but it did have that power. But over time, starting in the late 1800s, we had kind of a change come around where the fairly weak federal government started to gain more and more power. We had something called progressivism, which was kind of made famous by Teddy Roosevelt back in the, you know, late 1800s, early 1900s. And this was the idea that there were problems of a national nature that the federal government needed to be addressing that couldn't be adequately addressed by the states. And so for that, we needed a more powerful federal government. And we had things like child labor, for instance, that a lot of people thought was abhorrent to have a 10-year-old working in a coal mine, you know, and getting hurt and things doing that. So But there were a lot of states that depended on that kind of labor, and so states, we couldn't rely on them to outlaw stuff like that. And so a lot of people thought we needed the federal government to get involved. Things like monopolies, if you remember your early American history class, you know, things like Standard Oil and stuff that were nationwide. We needed the government to step in and break those up and do stuff to help the American consumer and whatever. And so we started to have a tendency for the federal government to start gaining more and more powers, that tried to regulate more and more stuff. And then in the Great Depression, it really hit passing gear there, gaining power. We had all this economic crisis that had developed, and the federal government just really grew exponentially during those days, starting all kinds of programs to get people employed, to take care of their basic needs like housing and food and stuff. And so the federal government, which had kind of been in the background for a long time, really came to the forefront and grew a whole lot, started doing all kinds of things. And you might wonder, well, how in the world did it get this much power? And the answer to that is it really found most of the source for this new power in the Commerce Clause. And the Commerce Clause, like I said, was a fairly, you know, mundane kind of thing. You'd think about regulating shipments of goods between, you know, one state and another across the border, you know, big deal. But the Commerce Clause became a source of immense federal power because the Supreme Court reinterpreted the Commerce Clause to mean not just, you know, interstate commerce itself, but things that affect interstate commerce can be regulated by Congress. The funny thing about that is that, surprisingly, almost everything affects interstate commerce. And let me tell you a silly story to kind of illustrate that principle. Let's say that you live in Nevada, Missouri, and you want to grow your own food and live off the land. And so you start planting carrots, and you're going to live off these carrots. And so you have a garden plot that's nice and big, and you start growing carrots. Okay, well, you think these carrots, which are, you know, planted in Missouri, they grow in Missouri, and I eat them in Missouri, and they never leave Missouri. That could never have anything to do with interstate commerce. So there's no way in the world that Congress should be able to regulate my growing these carrots. And that certainly makes common sense. But if you start to think about it, when you grow those carrots and you consume those carrots in your own home, that means that you're not going to go out to Walmart and buy carrots to eat in your house because you've already grown your own. And so because you're not going to go buy the carrots that were grown in California, shipped to Bentonville, and then up the I-49 to Nevada, that affects interstate commerce because you're cutting into the profits of California carrot farmers that had shipped their carrots across state lines. So you're growing carrots in your own backyard has affected interstate commerce. And granted, this is a silly example, but it really illustrates the principle that just about everything you do in your daily life in some way or another affects interstate commerce. And so the Supreme Court, using the Commerce Clause, gave an immense amount of power, probably more than the Founding Fathers could have ever dreamed of, to the federal government, to the point that it can regulate just about anything that we do. And the bottom line is federal power has expanded tremendously as a result of this doctrine and other things like it. The federal government, which started out being, you know, just taking care of things like national defense and diplomacy with other countries and, you know, shipments of goods between states and stuff like that, has grown over the last 200 years in ways the Founding Fathers would probably be spinning in their graves if they could, thinking about, because this has really had grown the power of the federal government tremendously. And so it's become very powerful. It affects our daily lives in a way that it didn't affect American citizens, you know, 100 years ago or more. And so the federal government's power has expanded in large part because of the Commerce Clause. All right, well, let's take a look now at the Bill of Rights. We mentioned earlier that in order to get the Constitution ratified, that they had to put in some amendments in order to list the rights of the people that the government was forbidden from interfering with. And that became the Bill of Rights. We won't look at all of them. If you take a good American government class, you'll look at them in much more detail and see what they all mean for you. And so there are some really important amendments that we're not going to look at. At least not much, like the Fourth Amendment, which applies to search and seizures. There's the Second Amendment, your right to have a gun, which probably won't affect you in your business life, hopefully, unless you're selling guns, and some things that we're just going to kind of leave to your government class. But we are going to look at some things that could arguably affect your career in business. First of all, we need to understand that as the way the Founding Fathers saw it, the Bill of Rights doesn't give us rights. Rather, those rights are God-given rights. We're born with those rights. And the way they saw it, we need to prevent the government from interfering with those God-given rights. And that's really what the Bill of Rights was designed to do, to explicitly forbid the federal government from messing with rights that you were born with. And so that's what they were designed to do. They're purposefully vague, and the whole Constitution was really written that way. And it's turned out to be a blessing, because if they had been really, really specific with things, and when they were writing it in 1789, it would have gotten out of date fairly quickly. But instead of spelling out the things that, for instance, they thought amounted to cruel and unusual punishment, they just let us figure that out through the courts. And so that definition has evolved over time. And so that has given us the ability to keep adapting the Constitution to our modern way of life. And so that's been very helpful in a lot of ways. They didn't really spell everything out, which is, in some ways, is kind of frustrating, because you can read the Constitution and still not know exactly what it means. You have to go look at court cases that have interpreted it. But it's also given it the flexibility it's needed to withstand the passage of two centuries and more worth of time. So that is one characteristic to understand, though. Something that's kind of interesting about the Bill of Rights, it applied only to the federal government at the beginning. It did not apply to the states. And so, for instance, the First Amendment's guarantee of free speech applied to the federal government, but there was nothing to stop the states from taking away your right to free speech at the start, at least, until something called the Incorporation Doctrine, which we'll look at in a little bit of detail because it's so important. In the 14th Amendment, which was passed after the original Bill of Rights, the 14th Amendment came in with a couple others right after the Civil War. It has what's called a due process clause, which makes the government be fair to you. And due process is a term you've probably heard before, maybe not clearly understood. Basically, there are two different kinds of due process, and it basically means the government has to treat you fairly. Substantive due process means that the government can't do unfair stuff to you. For instance, the government can't come in and snatch away your home and turn it into a highway without giving you some kind of money. That would be unfair. That would be a violation of your right to due process. And substantive due process means the government cannot do unfair stuff. Okay. Well, we also have procedural due process, which means the government can't do stuff in an unfair manner. So let's say that, for instance, the government comes in, takes your house, builds a highway, and sends you a check. But the government never gave you the chance to argue with what they value your house at. It never gave you notice they were going to do that. You just, went to work one day and you came home and your house had become a highway and they said, here's your check. You never had a chance to gripe about it. You never had a chance to try to change their mind. You weren't given notice, so they had done something. They might have given you a really nice check, to where what they did, the substance of it wasn't unfair, but the way they went about it was. And that's procedural due process. And so the Constitution demands that both things be protected, that you have to have substantive due process and procedural due process. So within the Bill of Rights, there is a due process clause in the Fifth Amendment, which actually applies to the federal government. But the 14th Amendment included one that applied to the states. And what the Supreme Court said later is that, due process, which involves fundamental fairness, what that really means is that most of the Bill of Rights actually applies to the state governments as well. So the states have to protect your free speech and not, commit unfair searches and seizures and things like that, that were protected by the original Bill of Rights. And so most of the Bill of Rights has been applied to the states now through the Incorporation Doctrine because of that due process clause of the 14th Amendment. So anyway, not all of the Bill of Rights, but most of it applies to the states thanks to the 14th Amendment's due process clause. One thing to understand about the Bill of Rights is that most people don't get this, as I hear just everyday conversation, but the Bill of Rights consists of prohibitions on what the government can do. It does not control what you or I as individual citizens can do. So, people will, be in their workplace or something and say, well, why do you say I can't talk about politics or religion? I have free speech. The First Amendment guarantee of free speech applies to the government. It does not apply to your boss necessarily. So these are prohibitions against the government interfering with things, not on private citizens. There may be other things that prevent private citizens from doing that, but the Bill of Rights only prevents the government from messing with your rights. It doesn't prevent private parties from doing that most of the time. So that's one thing to understand. You know, if you gripe to your buddy about he's violating your First Amendment rights, well, you don't have any First Amendment rights with respect to your buddy. You have your First Amendment rights with respect to the state and federal government. So just understand that. Okay, let's start our journey now through the Bill of Rights, at least through part of it, looking at particular amendments that have things that might actually have a direct impact on something to do with the world of business. The first is the First Amendment, and there's a lot going on in there. Let's just take the time to read the text of it. It says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. All right, let's try to figure out what that means for us. So there's a lot going on in the First Amendment. Let's kind of take it apart and see what the different pieces are doing. First of all, we see that we have a freedom of speech that is protected in the First Amendment. The first thing we need to realize, though, is that when it says Congress shall make no law, it doesn't really mean no law. It does means that we have this freedom, but it can be restricted in some common sense ways to protect the public good and safety and stuff. And really, all of our rights are this way. There's a balance between our individual rights and the good of society that is struck. The Supreme Court has helped us figure out exactly where those boundary lines are. But the freedom of speech isn't absolute. And there's a classic example of you can't yell fire in a crowded theater because people get trampled and killed, and that's bad. And certainly, the courts have helped us figure out that there are some restrictions that can be placed on the freedom of speech. Originally, they established that there is no prior restraints, and what that means is that we can't keep you from saying something we don't like. After you said something the government didn't like, then they could throw you in jail, but they couldn't keep you from saying it in the first place. And the courts fairly quickly realized that, well, that's really not free speech if we'll throw you in jail for saying it after the fact, but we'll let you say it. Well, that's not really free speech. And so we did away with that. We came up with something called the clear and present danger test later on, and by we, I mean the Supreme Court. And that basically said that, if you saying something is going to create a clear and present danger, then we can stop you from saying it. And so that was a fairly high burden because I can't think of too many things that just by opening your mouth, you can create a clear and present danger to the country. But anyway, if you did, we could stop you from doing that. And so this really came into all kinds of notoriety during the Vietnam War when there was all kinds of protests going on and stuff. And basically what the Supreme Court finally decided was that, if you're going to gripe about the government, say nasty things about the government, we can't stop you from doing that unless you're inciting people to a riot, basically, and what they called imminent lawless action. So basically, if you've got a crowd stirred up, think of Ferguson, Missouri, year or two ago, whatever. That might have been a situation where, people are throwing, rocks and firebombs and stuff like that, and you're stirring up the crowd. That's a clear and present danger. We can stop you from doing that. But for the most part, if you're just out there griping and telling, what you think is the truth about how nasty the government is, then, we can't stop you from doing that. It has to be more than that. Something to understand is that different types of speech have different levels of protection, and that's surprising to a lot of people. But we place different values on different kinds of speech. The most protected kind of speech is political speech. When you're talking about the government ought to do this or ought not to do this, or you're stumping for, one candidate or another, something like that, that is highly, highly protected. And the reason for that is because our democracy depends on that kind of stuff. We elect our leaders, we have free elections, we're a democracy. If we can't discuss the issues and discuss different political candidates and philosophies and things like that, our government ceases to function. So it is critically important that we be able to discuss that stuff. And so the government must have a very compelling reason to restrict that kind of speech. And that's hard. That's a hard barrier to get to. And so for the most part, we just have to let people talk about politics, and the government can't step in and stop that. That's highly, highly protected. For our purposes, though, it's good to know that commercial speech gets less protection. And the reason for that is if you are hawking a product, trying to get people to buy something, that, unlike political speech, is not critical to the functioning of our democracy. You know, the world will keep turning if they don't buy your as seen on TV product. Our democracy will continue to function. And so commercial speech is protected. It does have protection. But it can also be regulated more. And so we can have laws on things like false advertising that, you know, you can't rely on the First Amendment to say, well, I wanted to claim that, you know, my widget could do all kinds of things it can't do. No, we can regulate false advertising. We can throw you in jail for fraud or something like that. And you can't rely on free speech. Commercial speech is less protected. So if you're dealing with, you know, trying to get people to buy something, that's protected, but it's less protected than political speech would be. It's also good to know that symbolic speech is treated just like verbal speech. And so the classic case that came out is called Tinker versus Des Moines School District or something like that. Happened in the 60s, again, protests of the Vietnam War, where these school kids were wearing black armbands to protest the war, and the principal or whatever told them to take them off. They didn't want to, and it ended up being a case before the Supreme Court. And they, you know, the argument was, well, they weren't saying anything, you know, so we can, you know, make them stop. You know, they weren't opening their mouths, they weren't writing anything, and the Supreme Court has said, no, if your symbolic speech, you know, is, you know, by doing something like wearing that armband, we're going to treat that just like verbal speech. And so that kind of speech is treated the exact same way as verbal speech, basically. When we're regulating speech, even political speech, we can have what are called reasonable time, place, and manner restrictions. So let's say, for instance, that you're engaging in political speech, which is highly protected. You're stumping for your brother-in-law who is running for Jasper County Sheriff, and so you get a van and fill it full of speakers and amplifiers, and you drive through neighborhoods of Joplin, Missouri at 2 in the morning on a Sunday, you know, using the loudspeakers and trying to get people to vote for your brother-in-law. Okay, we don't like that because that's waking people up, it's disturbing the peace, it's doing all kinds of things, and that's political speech in its purest form, but we can regulate the time, place, and manner. So we could say, okay, you can't do something like that except between the hours of 8 and 5, except in a particular part of town, and you have to have your loudspeakers turned to a certain decibel level or whatever. We can regulate the time, place, and manner of stuff. And so we can have those kinds of reasonable restrictions. So you can't say, oh, well, I want to, you know, block I-49 for 3 hours and engaging in symbolic speech protesting something. No, we can regulate that. You know, you can say what you want to say, but we can regulate to some degree in a reasonable manner where and when you say it. So that's important to realize. And also the location of speech matters. If you are, you know, going through residential neighborhoods, doing stuff in people's yards and claiming free speech, you know, you have less protection than you would if you were trying to do that on the courthouse steps. Because in a public setting, you know, where people normally gather in a public way, you have more protection there than you would in some private thing. If you're doing it on, you know, private property or something else, you know, the location does matter. And we won't get into all the details of this, but just realize that that is an issue, that more regulation can be put on you in some places rather than others. Still in the First Amendment, we have the freedom of the press, and this is closely related to the freedom of speech. And this was really important to the folks back when they were writing the Bill of Rights, because you know, they were used to getting all their news you know, through newspapers and stuff, and the British had tried to censor things that they didn't like. And so they wanted to make sure that their new government would not be interfering with that. And media is completely necessary for functioning democracy, because people need to be informed about the issues and about different candidates and things like that in order to be informed voters. And so we need to have a free and functioning media in order to have a functioning democracy. And so that's really important. And so that is enshrined in the First Amendment. Some censorship has been allowed, you know, especially like in wartime or something. If you want to publish in the newspaper, you know, what the secret plans are to attack the enemy, you know, we're not going to allow that. So some censorship can be allowed under certain situations. Just like any other freedom, it has its limits. Also, we have freedom of religion in the First Amendment. There's a lot in there. There are two major parts of freedom of religion. We have the Establishment Clause, which says that government can't tell you what to believe. In The olden days, for instance, in Great Britain, there is the Church of England, which is a state-supported church. They use tax money, basically, to support the Church of England. It is the official church. Nowadays, you can belong to some other church, but the Church of England is the established official church. And that rubbed a lot of people the wrong way. And a lot of people who ended up in the 13 colonies came because they believed something other than the Church of England believed. And so they wanted to set forth the fact that, you know, our national government cannot pick an official religion and tell you what you are supposed to believe, make you pay taxes to support some kind of church that you may or may not believe in. So that's the Establishment Clause. We also have the Free Exercise Clause, which says that government has to let you practice what you do believe. And there are some limits on that, as we will see. But basically, government can't tell you what you have to believe, and it has to let you believe what you want to believe. So those are really two different parts. Let's look at the Establishment Clause a little more carefully. First of all, like we said, government cannot establish an official religion. It cannot set up the Church of the United States and make everyone pay taxes to support that. That is clearly forbidden. However, that idea has been expanded quite a bit by the courts. Now we can have no apparent endorsement of religion. So we don't want the government to get involved in favoring, you know, or acting like it favors one type of religion over another or something like that. That has evolved through Supreme Court cases into the doctrine of separation of church and state, which is probably a familiar phrase to you. That phrase is really not found in the Constitution, but that's kind of what's developed as we've interpreted the Establishment Clause, is that we don't want basically the government to get involved in religion at all, or vice versa. We want to keep those two things separate. It's been expressed as also we don't want the government to be excessively entangled in religion. And there are some flashpoints for this. For instance, sometimes the government will give grants to religious charities that are helping people and doing really good things. And we'll allow some of that. But if it looks like the government is really endorsing, you know, some religious activity or something, that's a big no-no. And we'll see the Establishment Clause rear its ugly head a lot of times at Christmas time or something, where, you know, a courthouse lawn tries to put out some Christmas decorations and people get offended and the ACLU gets involved and stuff like that. And so this is an ongoing area of litigation. Interestingly enough, there's a whole body of law, and, you know, not all of it's that pertinent to the world of business, so we're not going to get into it too much, but just know that the Establishment Clause has really been expanded, and we really want to keep the government from getting entangled in religion. Interestingly, you know, with the classic nativity scene on the courthouse lawn kind of problem, just kind of illustrates you how this has been handled. We have something called, and I kid you not, the plastic reindeer test, which is that if we have courthouse lawn decorations, you know, we have, you know, the little baby Jesus or something like that, people start to, you know, raise their eyebrows about that because it looks like we're endorsing religion. But if we also have, like, Santa Claus and his reindeers, you know, and stuff that are fairly secular Christmas symbols or whatever, and just kind of holiday symbols that don't have an overtly religious theme, then that kind of softens the blow there, and we will maybe allow those decorations to be there on the courthouse lawn and let the government put out that stuff, because it doesn't look like they're endorsing religion if they have all these secular symbols as well. And, you know, they may put out a Star of David and something celebrating Ramadan too, or whatever, and try to be equal to everyone. And so, anyway, for our purposes, just know that this can be an issue, and it could be a real issue. You know, if you end up running some kind of organization that has something to do with, you know, religion, you know, you're trying to get a government grant, you know, this could be a real problem for you. So this is worth knowing something about. Continuing on now with the First Amendment, freedom of religion. We have the Establishment Clause. We also have the Free Exercise Clause. And again, this makes sure that the government can allow you to believe whatever you want to believe. It cannot stop you from believing anything. So the government is completely forbidden from passing a law saying, thou shalt not believe thus and such. And they have to let you believe whatever you want to. But as you might imagine, acting on those beliefs is a little more problematic. There can be government regulation of that if there is a compelling government interest in doing so. Well, why, you know, that seems kind of, you know, unfair. You know, you want to practice your religion. Why is the government going to get involved in that? Well, Let's, for example, imagine that you want to resurrect the ancient Mayan religion, which involved having human sacrifices where you get somebody and rip out their beating heart and sacrifice them to the gods. And so you want to abduct your neighbor and rip out his beating heart and sacrifice him to the Mayan gods. Can we stop you from doing that? Absolutely. There is a compelling government interest in protecting your neighbor from you. And so there are limits that we can put on practicing those beliefs. Of course, that's an extreme example, but we have other examples that have cropped up. My favorite case name of all time is the Church of the Lukumi Babalu Aye versus the City of Hialeah, which came out of Florida. And in this case, there was a church that was a little unusual, we'll say, that took up residence in the city of Hialeah, Florida. And as part of their church services, they liked to sacrifice animals. And the city fathers in Hialeah were just shocked by this. They thought it was horrible, so they passed an ordinance saying you cannot sacrifice animals. And that ended up in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said, you know what, if you wanted to go butcher a duck and eat it for your Sunday dinner, it's legal. And why are you trying to tell these people they can't, you know, cut off a duck's head because they believe in God? So the government did not have a compelling interest in keeping these people from sacrificing animals. But you can see, you know, where tensions might arise here. If there is a compelling government interest, then we can regulate your religious activity. But, you know, I guess protecting the life of a duck isn't a compelling government interest. So, but there may be situations where that would arise. Somewhere else where this has come up is where Native Americans, in practicing their religion, want to use hallucinogenic drugs such as peyote, which comes from a cactus, I believe, where they basically take this drug and get high and go on vision quests and that kind of thing. And they have a real legitimate religious reason for doing that. That's part of their ancient heritage. But we have federal drug laws that say you can't get high on stuff. And so there's been some conflict there. And the Supreme Court has sided with the Native Americans in a lot of different cases and saying that, well, you know, you're trying to keep people from getting high isn't compelling enough to keep these people from practicing their religion. They're not hurting anyone else. And so, you know, let them eat their peyote or whatever you do with peyote. I have no idea. But so we have different situations where this may become a problem. Sometimes, interestingly enough, the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause come into conflict, and we'll see this especially like in a school environment. For instance, let's say that you have the school football team that wants to have a prayer before they go out on the field and play a football game. Okay, well, the Establishment Clause tells us that we can't have the entanglement between government and religion, and a public school is part of the government. That's part of the state government. And so that's why we don't have school prayer and things like that, which is somewhat controversial. Because basically the school board, you know, is put there by the state, it's part of the state government. We don't want them to get involved in religion. Okay, so based upon that and the separation of church and state and everything, we may not want those public school students having a prayer there on public school property during public school time for a public school activity. And so we can understand under that interpretation of the Establishment Clause why that would be the case. But on the other hand, we have the Free Exercise Clause where, you know, we want people to be able to practice their religion. And is there a compelling government interest in keeping someone from saying a prayer? You know, we can't imagine why, maybe, but so you can see how sometimes the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause could come into conflict, which is kind of interesting and unexpected, I think, for most people. Okay. So also within the First Amendment, you know, they threw a whole lot in there. Freedom of assembly is in there, the freedom of the people peaceably to assemble and seek redress of their grievances from the government. Basically, you can meet together in large groups and gripe about stuff if you want to. Some countries don't allow this today, you know, and the People's Republic of China, they can control stuff like this. They don't want large groups of people getting together to gripe about the government. They can outlaw that. But in the United States, in a democracy, we allow that, and that's important. So that is protected by the First Amendment. Let's move on now to the Fifth Amendment. And again, we're skipping several amendments, but they're all important, just not all that important for business necessarily. But the Fifth Amendment does have at least a couple of features that are. We're not going to read all of this. I'll let you do that on your own time if you want to. You can pause the presentation. But there's a lot in here. A lot of it has to do with criminal cases and how, you know, people who can be accused of a crime can be treated and that sort of thing. Frankly, the Founding Fathers weren't really good about doing things topically. And so they would throw all kinds of things into an amendment that didn't necessarily belong together in my mind, but they're the founding fathers and I'm not. So anyway, what we want to concentrate on though is here toward the end, where it says something about due process of law, which we've already talked about, that notion, where you can't be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. Okay. Well, what we have there is what's called the Federal Due Process Clause. And again, we talked about what due process is and what it means. It basically ensures fundamental fairness. And in this particular case, it explicitly says the government cannot take your property without paying for it. So if the government wants to build an Air Force base right where your house sits, it can do that. But it has to take your property in a fair manner and it has to pay you a fair amount of money for that privilege. It can't just go condemning property and taking it for free. That doesn't work. On its face, this only applies to the federal government. And the Federal Due Process Clause is what it's called. It only applies to the national government in Washington, D.C. Remember, though, that basically the same protections are given to us from the state government as well, thanks to the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause, which we already mentioned a little bit earlier. So we have the same type of protection applies to us. The state government can't come turn your house into some public work without a fair process, and neither can the federal government. So the same type of protection applies to both the state and the federal governments. We also have the Seventh Amendment, which says, in suits at common law where the value of controversy shall exceed $20, the right of trial by jury shall be preserved, and no fact tried by a jury shall be otherwise reexamined in any court of the United States than according to the rules of the common law. Okay, this deals with jury trials in civil cases, not criminal cases, but civil cases. Suits at common law. So when you're suing someone, this is what it deals with. Well, this gives you a right to a jury trial if your controversy exceeds the value of $20. Well, this is an area where the founding fathers weren't as smart as they could have been because they never thought about inflation. In 1789, $20, I don't know how much it was, but it was worth a whole lot more than it is today. We wouldn't bother suing someone over $20 today. The filing fee is like $150. So, but this was a huge amount of money to them. They didn't index this for inflation, so this amendment kind of has done some silly things. And it has not been applied to the states through the incorporation doctrine of the 14th Amendment, nor will it ever be. That's because if we applied this amendment to the states requiring a jury trial in every civil case that's worth more than $20, we would have to have a jury trial in every single civil case because every single one would be about more than $20. And so no longer could you have small claims court. And so because it only applies to the federal government, the states are free to create that small claims court. So if you're griping with your neighbor, you know, the things that you see on Judge Judy, you know, somebody didn't pay their rent, you know, and it's $500. You don't have to have a jury trial for that. You can just get in front of a judge and the judge can decide who won and whatever. And so with small claims and stuff, we don't want to have to go to the expense of a jury trial. That's really expensive. It takes a whole lot of time. It inconveniences a lot of people to have to sit on that jury. That would be ridiculous. And so this is never going to be applied to the states for that reason alone. But anyway, it would cause problems with the federal courts, except for Congress adjusted the amount of controversy requirement for diversity cases. And so that kind of takes care of that. You know, the federal question cases, you know, there's really no amount in controversy requirement. And so this would apply to that, but there that really doesn't have that big of an effect. But it would also apply to diversity cases if we didn't have that amount in controversy. So anyway, Seventh Amendment's kind of a curiosity in a way. Doesn't have that any effect on the states at all, but kind of guarantees a jury trial in several federal cases. Let's move along now to the Tenth Amendment. The Tenth Amendment says the power is not delegated to the United States, and that is the federal government in Washington, by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. This is really where we get the term reserved powers, that if it's not explicitly given to the federal government, it's reserved for the states. But the Tenth Amendment has really kind of been eviscerated and doesn't really have that much power anymore. It says on its face, if the Constitution didn't give the federal government the power to do something, it can't do it, which was a principle that the founders thought was obvious. But The 10th Amendment really spells it out, but it's largely lost its teeth due to things like the Commerce Clause coming in and implying so much power in ways that perhaps the federal or the fathers of the Constitution had never really thought about giving to the federal government. But for better or worse, our country has evolved over time to the point that the federal government has a lot of power that to do things that probably the founding fathers had never dreamed of, but it works. So that's what we do. But the 10th Amendment, you know, says that about reserve power. So that's where we get that. So that's largely why I'm showing you that now. Let's talk briefly. We're actually out of the Bill of Rights now. That was the first 10 amendments. But the 13th, 14th, and 15th amendments have things in them that are pretty important, especially in a practical matter, right, for business. They were passed right after the Civil War, so again, you know, they weren't original to the Bill of Rights, which was passed along with the Constitution and came into force in the late 1780s and 1790s. So they were seeking to address things that were brought up by the Civil War. Specifically, we wanted to give equal rights to former slaves and guarantee their rights as citizens under the law. And we can kind of see that in the different amendments. They try to give voting rights to these former slaves, make sure they won't be discriminated against in that way. As we know from American history, though, sometimes, you know, we fell short in that, trying to make sure people actually enjoyed the rights that they were given. So we had the civil rights movement in the 20th century and designed to correct that, and perhaps we're still working on that. So, but these are amendments trying to guarantee equal rights for everyone. And so by virtue of that, they become very, very important, especially in things like employment law and discrimination and stuff like that. They're really the basis for those sorts of legal protections. Let's look at the 14th Amendment in detail. It says, all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. And no state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. Now, these types of protections are things that we already had in the Bill of Rights, but they only applied to the federal government. And the 14th Amendment was unique in that it applied these sorts of protections to the states. And what we didn't want to have happen is for the federal government to say, okay, all these freed slaves have all these rights, and then the governor of Mississippi, which didn't like the freed slaves, comes in and tries to take away their rights. So this explicitly applies the same types of protections to citizens of a state to keep the state government from infringing on their rights, the same types of protections they had from the federal government. And here we have the 14th Amendment's Due Process Clause, which we've already talked about, incorporates the protections of the Bill of Rights, or most of them anyway, and forces them on the state governments to keep the state governments from depriving us of the same rights that the federal government already couldn't deprive us of. We already looked at the 14th Amendment, again, it has the Equal Protection Clause in there, as well as the Due Process Clause. It says the government can't discriminate against its own citizens, so it can't treat different people differently. And again, over history, that hasn't always worked out that way, but that's in there. And if we're treating different classes of people different ways, we have to be very careful about that. It can happen. Certain classifications of people can be treated different ways by the law under certain circumstances. But there are some different classifications, such as race, so where we are very, very, very suspicious. If a government is trying to treat different races differently, that is subject to judicial review. The courts will take a look at that and apply what is called strict scrutiny, which means you have to have a really darn good reason if you're going to apply that kind of discriminatory effect on your own citizens. If you're treating people of different races differently, we're going to be very, very interested in why that is happening, and we're not going to allow that except in a really, really, really compelling situation. It's hard to imagine one in most cases. So different types of discrimination under the law is subject to this strict scrutiny, and it'll be struck down pretty easily unless the government has a really, really good reason. So race is a classification that's subject to strict scrutiny. So is religion. You know, the state of Missouri says, you know, we're not going to hire Catholics, you know, for state jobs or something. And that's subject to strict scrutiny. That's going to be struck down more likely than not. So certain classifications are subject to that strict scrutiny. Sometimes we have something called intermediate scrutiny, and that's applied to things like gender. You and I know that common sense tells us men and women are put together differently, our minds and bodies work a little bit differently, and sometimes it makes perfect rational sense to treat the different genders differently. But we don't want that to become unfair discrimination. And so if the government is treating the genders differently, for instance, that will be subject to some scrutiny, not strict scrutiny, because we know that sometimes there is a good reason for that. But we're going to look at that pretty hard. Age may be looked at that in the same way. You know, for instance, you know, sometimes we make airline pilots retire after they reach a certain age because we don't want them to crash a plane, you know, so that's important. That's a compelling interest, but we'll look at that and make sure that it's really necessary to discriminate on that basis. And so that's kind of an in-between thing. Most of the time, though, when the government, state, or federal passes a law and the courts are reviewing it, you know, if it has some kind of discrimination or something on some other basis, it's not a protected class like race or gender or something like that, doesn't have anything to do with that, we'll just look at what's called a rational basis test. In other words, is there some kind of semi-logical argument that the government has, some rational reason for doing what it's doing? It may have a really stupid reason for doing what it's doing, but if it's, you know, makes some kind of sense, we'll let them get away with it. And so if it doesn't involve some kind of suspect discrimination like that. So when courts are reviewing laws, sometimes the Equal Protection Clause comes into play. And so just know that, you know, discrimination on race and religion is really looked at hard. Gender and age and things like that is looked at pretty hard as well. And then other things, you know, the government can pretty much pass whatever laws it wants to without getting into trouble on this. So those are the different kinds of review that the courts will apply. Again, I will reiterate that equal protection and the other constitutional provisions apply only to governments, not private actors. The 14th Amendment's protections only apply to state governments. Similar protections are in the rest of the Bill of Rights, and they apply to the federal government. But that doesn't apply to private actors, you know, in private businesses, individual citizens, that kind of thing. You know, if I'm a racist and I don't want to hang out with people of a certain race and I want to discriminate in choosing my friends, that's okay. I have the right to do that. This does not apply to me. This by it, you know, on its face doesn't apply to private actors. Now, we will see as we study employment law and some other things down the road, Congress has used its power under the Commerce Clause to prohibit discriminatory activity, even in private areas. And so if I run a hotel, I cannot put up a sign that says no black people allowed. That's illegal. And if I'm hiring people, you know, I can't discriminate on the basis of race or religion or these other things. And so some of these same protections are built in, but they're passed by Congress in a statute. They, you know, the Constitution doesn't prohibit that by itself. That only applies to state actors. So anyway, again, that's a misconception that's pretty common in dealing with the Bill of Rights. So I want to make that clear.